making adjustments from there. I can't really tell how bright something is unless I can see how something dark something is, so I have to get this all masked in so I can see what the relationships are like. And as you can see, I'm using a fairly well-used brush, which is, I love these old brushes sometimes. They're really broken in, you can get a lot of great coverage with an old brush. So I'm basically mixing together my cinnabar, a little bit of a Hansa, a little bit of my Blick green here, permanent green. So there we go. And I'm using, of course, a little liquid. And I'm trying to keep the integrity of my initial composition, the big shapes, right now. Trying not to get seduced by any little details, which is really, really easy to do. There's all kinds of beautiful little things here that would be great things, that are great things that are painted or attracting my eye. But I need to keep focused on the big picture and not get seduced by details, which is a mistake or something I fell victim to very early on when I started going out planar painting. I would get really almost overwhelmed by the variety of and the plethora of detail. But I've gotten better at being able to hold that off now. Save that until later. Again, I'm blurring, constantly blurring my eye, closing one eye, closing my left eye, opening my right eye, blurring my right eye, so I can just see the value, or the value of the color. Open my eye to see the chroma of the color. So, constantly squinting, going back and forth between squinting and not squinting. Again, I think of it almost as if I was carving these shapes or cutting these shapes with a scissor, and not getting caught up in trying, again, to be seduced by painting little leaves or anything like that. All that kind of stuff comes at the end of the painting, and depending upon how much time I have at the end of the painting, too. You have to be willing to be a little bit fearless and also be willing to go back over and sometimes destroy or build on or build through something that you've already stated. Actually show you my palette. So what I have here is I have a basic core color that I mixed, and then I mix in and out of it. I mix into it to make it brighter or more chromatic, or I'll mix into it to make it darker or less chromatic, and put a little blue into something, a little brown into something. So I mix a big pool of that middle green color, and then I work out of that. Again, I'm keeping my paint fairly thin at this point, just to sort of establish everything. And then I'll start adding more viscosity as I progress with the painting. I find that if I start out with too much in the beginning, too much paint, it doesn't necessarily allow me to go back in later on and to restate things as easily. I end up having too much on there. Sometimes I have to scrape it off. So I'm really looking at the shapes the shadows cut. I blur my eye, I don't see the details of the leaves. What I see is the shape the light makes when it hits a branch and makes a shadow. So I'm looking, I'm constantly blurring my eyes and looking at the shadow shapes. And you will see more green than any color, any other color, when you're landscaping, because the human eye is the most sensitive to the color green. Because this has happened through evolution or hunter-gatherer ancestors. So for me, one of the things I really focus on is the different greens. It's not all green, and it's certainly not all green right out of the tube. One of the other things that's happening is everything is being affected by the light bouncing off of everything else. So you have the sun, you have the sky reflecting down, you have the ground reflecting up, you have all the leaves reflecting onto each other. So you have the overall quality of the atmosphere of the light, which is actually pretty good today. It's not a little hazy. There's a little haze in the air, but not a lot. So I tend to try to group my greens in a way when I'm looking at them is this a warm green or is this a cool green? You know, is it a minty green, a light minty green? Or is it a darker minty green? Again, that's why you have to sort of slow down, start to think about what you're looking at, so that you can start making these types of decisions. This bush here is very vibrant, and then right next to it, it gets slightly, still warm, but it's a little patch of bushes is a little cooler. It's a very subtle thing. Sometimes for the painting, you have to kind of push that subtlety a little bit, I find, in order for it to read. Because there's no way I can paint the bazillions of colors that my eye is detecting. And this painting is an abstraction. Even if it's, you know, realistic to a certain extent, it's still an abstraction. I cannot possibly paint all the colors that my eye can detect. I know some people like to use the Viva paper towels, but I'd rather save money on paper towels and spend it on my paint. So this is the dollar a roll paper towel. Now also, because there's a little stream here, some of this color is going to reflect down into that stream. So again, that's why I have this nice little pool of color here. And the color is not the same. It's actually if I blur my eyes, I can actually see that the color in this, the reflection of the grass, the trees in the stream, is actually pretty dark compared to the rest of the greens up here. So realize that I have to go much darker than I actually think I do. Always end up taking extra photos in case I need to make an adjustment on something later to get back to the studio and I say, wow, this is really needs to be a little bit different. Again, I'm just looking, blurring my eyes and looking at the shapes, shadow shapes here. And that's going to help me quite a bit. All right, now we're getting starting to get the sun is starting to shift, I see, so I'm going to have to work a little faster to get all this sort of blocked in. So you have to be always thinking 2 hours, 3 hours ahead. Okay, so moving on, colors are starting, the shadows are starting to shift, so I'm aware that my color shapes, my shadow shapes, are all going to start to shift now. So I have to be conscious of thinking about where things are going to be down the road a little bit in time-wise on my painting. And right now it just looks like a bunch of patches of color. But as time goes by, I will start to refine these shapes a little bit more and a little bit more and a little bit more. So big key for me is this, what this shadow is going to be down here. It's going to be cooler and darker. I'm trying to find them. Sort of the middle value of this color. Middle value of this area. also have here is a big shift as the go down into the stream, and there's the edge of the ground there, but also the plain is a gradual plain made up of the levels of the leaves sort of terracing down. So just refining the value statement that I made earlier, and I see that I think these are a little bit more of a, these are brighter, but a little bit more cool. And I want to get the stump in, or whatever this bunch of branches and stuff. It's a shape. And I don't really want to worry about any of the detail yet. Just get the overall sort of like exploded star shape. Back end of the brush is great sometimes for helping get a shape. Just kind of scrape down on it. Define a shape. Thinking about the planes again. Plane of the stream here. So can I put a few shapes in for myself here that will help define that? There's a plane. So I want to get this shape in before it changes too much.
You know, these little shapes like that really help give you that convincing sense of that plane receding back. This is one of the reasons why I like to sort of kind of ratty old brush a little bit, because it helps give you these nice sort of like irregular shapes. And as you come forward, that shadow becomes a little bit more chromatic. Then that's one of the reasons why I don't use black on these types of paintings on your outside, because nothing is actually black. Everything has some color to it. Every shadow, even the darkest shadow, is not black. It has light bouncing into it. So now that I've got everything covered, now I can start going back in and making specific, more like the next level of choices of detail. Again, you know, looking at the shadow shapes, blurring my eye. Sometimes I think, does that make sort of a letter shape or a, you know, squashed E shape? Is that a banana shape? Is that a shape like a number? Also, you know, paying attention to the rhythm of the foliage, the rhythm, the shape of the leaf or the branch. So to me, this sort of makes like a series of E shapes. Again, it's constantly going back and refining these statements that you made before. Try to keep my shadow masses grouped. We can keep these all grouped, even though there is a slight variation of chroma. They're all, if I blur my eye, they're all pretty much the same, and that helps keep the shadows and the light